Hello and welcome to Commodity Champions. I'm Anisha Gupta, and it has been the crude oil prices that have kept the markets busy. With volatility at the highest in last 2 years, the crude oil prices are actually down 25% since early October. This is due to the supply hike from US, OPEC and Russia, all the major oil producers. The US crude output actually has gone up by 22% in 2018 to an all-time high of 11.6 million barrels. The important thing to watch out would be the OPEC and the allies, who are now discussing a proposal to cut output by 1.4 million barrels per day from the current levels in their next meeting, that is on December 6th and 7th. When you look at the global agencies, the International Energy Agency is implying that the market will see a stock buildup for the first half of 2019 by almost 2 million barrels per day. So that is something that these oil producers will really have to look to balance on. But on the other hand, you have the U.S. natural gas prices, which are up 48% in the month of November, and the stocks are at 15-year lows, and that clearly has been supporting the prices. This also is due to the lower inventories, with the inventories being 16% low or below the five-year average. Moreover, there have been forecasts of record exports from U.S., and that also has led to the natural gas prices gaining further higher. But before we welcome the expert of the day, let's also listen into what the OPEC General Secretary Mohammed Barkindo has to say about the OPEC and, of course, the crude oil prices.
The price volatility, in our opinion, is being driven by the heightened anxiety, the heightened uncertainties in the market being introduced from outside the parameters of the oil market, the geopolitics of the time, the uncertainties that are being driven by this geopolitics, by decisions taken outside the industry itself but impacting on us, which the financial institutions, the key financial players, are also taking cue from and taking positions.
Well, that clearly is the OPEC General Secretary saying about the reasons that are triggering the volatility in the crude oil markets. Let's also now tune in to Anthony Chan, the chief economist at Chase, and Jurian Timmer of Fidelity Investments on what they are picking up as far as the demand-supply picture is concerned.
If you ask me which one is the over-dominating factor, it has to be supply. We're seeing the U.S. really producing more oil than it's ever produced oil. And we are also seeing that other countries are also ramping up production. So supply is certainly dominating demand. And by the way, when you look at the U.S. economy, 4.2% growth in the second quarter, 3.5%, you're not seeing a lack of demand on the part of the U.S. And even China, now they're ramping up stimulus, monetary policy. They are lowering interest rates. They're also doing more fiscal policy.
The demand side for oil has been robust, but there's clearly some slowing, and then you have some short-term concerns about supply, and we're hearing, you know, all the news about OPEC. So, you know, oil's down about 20%, but commodities in general are down, and I do think China plays a large role. It's one of the key components that we try to figure out in terms of this puzzle for next year. We know we're in this holding pattern in the U.S. market this year, but next year a few things have to come together. Commodities are a highly volatile asset class, so a 20% decline in oil is not the same as a 20% decline in the S&P 500, for instance.
Well, that, of course, is the global view on the crude oil supply, demand and prices. But back home, we are now joined by Navneet Damani of Motilal Oswal to talk to us about the strategies that he's making for you for the crude oil and other commodities for the week that is coming. Navneet, hi. Thank you so much for joining us. Well, the major moves in this week, of course, have all come in for the energy space, where we have seen the crude oil prices continue to decline. Would you say that all the negative news has been factored in, or is there more room downside?
Well, Manisha, we've seen crude oil prices correcting very sharply, and the fall is close to 29% from its peak. And it looks like much of the bad news has been already discounted into the prices. But going through some CFTC position, it looks like that short positions are not really very aggressive at the moment. So we do not expect any kind of short covering to trigger any kind of up move at the moment. Also, historically, we've seen that the volatility has peaked at about 60-70% or even higher levels, which is not the case in the last fall that we've seen. So there could be some more room for downside for crude oil prices. But having said that, after the steep downfall, there could be a bit of pullback, and we are expecting that 3-5% upside could be in store. Immediate case, it looks like we are headed towards 60 and 61 for the WTI before any meaningful correction once again.
Sure. So, Navneet, how would you make the strategies from here, considering that the Indian rupee has been a lot volatile as well? We've seen quite a bit of an appreciation come in from all-time lows that the rupee did hit in this year itself. How are you looking at the falling crude oil prices and the rupee appreciation? Would that mean more declines for the Indian markets?
Well, Indian crude oil prices have corrected from about 5,600 levels to sub 4,000 levels currently. My bias still looks to be negative as the rupee still keeps on appreciating, and crude oil has been a large factor which has kept the rupee under pressure. So now, since prices have corrected largely, it's going to change the fiscal math of the country, and that in a way is going to lend some kind of support to the INR prices as well. We believe that 7170 and 7150 could be on card for the INR. In similar way, we expect that any level close to 3950 is where we are seeing some kind of bottoming out for the short term for the crude oil on the domestic exchanges.
And well, not everything is slipping down. You have the natural gas prices, which have shown strong gains on the upside. How are you strategizing on these prices? Do you see further gains? Because we've seen inventories decline. We've seen cold weather, strong exports. How much of further upside would you see then in natural gas?
Well, we've seen natural gas gaining in a total of about 55-56% over the last one and a half months. Expectation of a severe winter is now panning out, and probably over the last 2-3 days there have been news articles reporting that December could be even more severe than what we have seen in November. And similar could be the case for January and so forth. Inventories are way below the 5-year average at the moment, and they continue to deplete every week on week. Today we have the natural gas inventories also. So in a way, if inventories continue to deplete again, there could be some bit of more upside on the prices. But I would not like to participate in this kind of rally at the moment, and probably a healthy correction is where we will look to enter the natural gas once again.
So, Navneet, if you had to look at the overall energy sector for this year, we are close to the year ending. It has been very, very volatile. When would you look at the prices now? If you look at the whole year in perspective, we've seen supply issues, demand, Iran, global concerns, etc. How are you reading into all of these fundamentals now?
See, if we see in a totality, crude oil prices is where we started the year from. So it took about 10 months for the prices to rally, and in a matter of 1 month, the prices have vanished away all the gains. So for the year-to-day perspective, there are not much of gains which are recorded for crude oil prices. I believe that there have been a lot of events for this year, starting from Iran to sanctions across many large nations, to very sharp depletion of inventories, and that in a way has left the crude oil prices not immune. But U.S. production continues to rise every successive month. It's been reported that the production is adding, and it's expected to cross 1.2 million barrels in the coming quarter as well. So my bias is that dips could be there for prices, but the sharp sell-off that we've seen should not continue entering 2019.
And finally, before we let you go, Navneet, one word on the metal space as well, because almost all the industrial metals are down double digit in 2018. Any favorites that you are picking up now on the bigger side here? Because the markets still are looking at weak Chinese data. It also has to do about the US-China trade concerns, where we do see some undershoots or green shoots now finally coming in. Do you see these reasons and, of course, the individual fundamentals being an impetus for you to go out and buy some of these metals?
Well, there have been a lot of concerns. The year started for the metals with a very positive note, and then came the sanctions from the US, and that in a way has taken away much of the gains for the year. But selective metals have been performing very well, and aluminium is one metal which has been in the positive territory on the year-to-date basis. My best bet still remains copper amongst the fundamental plays. We see that inventories on all the three exchanges are down to multi-year low, and in totality, if we see that it's lower than what they were in 2008 when we've seen a big rally into prices. Cash to 3-month position is indicating a tight backwardation at the moment, and that is in a way indicating a positive trend. So if we see crude oil prices stabilizing and dollar index kind of reversing from here on, our bet is that base metals could start to regain strength once again, and best bet amongst the lot could be zinc and copper in the coming days.
All right. Those, of course, are the favorite picks in the metal space coming in from Navneet. Navneet, thank you so much for joining us with your strategies. And then it is that time now when we give you the commodity champion of the week. And we are talking milk this time. India's largest crop in terms of value at 6.5 lakh crore rupees. After putting the country on map as world's largest milk producer, Amul is now vying for a major exporter as well. R.S. Sodhi, the managing director of Amul, now joins us on the show to talk about dairy space, the launches, and of course, on what we are looking at in sense of supply, demand, and prices. Mr. Sodhi, hi, thank you so much for joining us. Milk as a commodity is getting recognition now as an important export item from the country also. What is your sense when we talk about India's supply demand and, of course, kind of exports that we are looking at from here on?
Well, you see, last 3-4 years from India, commodity export of dairy was not happening. No doubt, the branded consumer product growth was coming around 20-25%. But commodity export was not happening because of the price competitors not there. But for the last 2 months, we have become now competitive. And I feel that in case of Amul, last year if our export was of around 240-250 crore, this year our target is to achieve export of our 1,000 crore of dairy products. And our target is to export around 60,000 metric ton of skim milk powder against last year just 2,000 or 3,000 ton. And the way Indian milk production is growing, you know, India is world's largest producer of milk, India is world's largest market, and India is also fastest growing milk production and consuming country. And but farmers are producing more. I mean, we are getting around 12-15% more milk. No doubt, India we are selling, consume, and consumption is growing. But countries around India, all neighboring countries, you take Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Middle East, Southeast country, all are milk deficit. All are importing right now milk products from either from Europe or from the Australia, New Zealand. But we are next door. So now gradually we are increasing our exports to our neighboring countries.
Mr. Sodhi, that point is well taken, but what is your sense on the prices now within India? Because we do understand that the selling price of milk is almost double of the procurement price. How do you look at those prices in the country? And also, when we talk about the international markets, what kind of export prices do you see India fetching from there on?
Well, last 1.5-2 years, there has been no price increase, neither to the farmers nor to the consumers. Price had been stagnant because of glut in Indian milk market as well as world over. But now gradually prices are improving as far as commodity is concerned. But increasing is price, I don't expect in the next 6 months as far as farmers or consumers are concerned. But gradually commodity prices are increasing, and by the end of March, I expect prices to start increasing.
Well, one of the concerns that we always have seen in milk and dairy products is spurious or, adulterated milk, as we see it. The FSI report, though, suggests that only 90% of milk is safe to consume, and 10% because of perhaps poor farm practices is adulterated and is not safe for consumption. How have you read this report, and what really needs to be done in this direction?
You see, this time the FSSI report has come very good. I think it has cleared all the doubts which were otherwise floating around in the media that India 70-80% is adulterated milk. Now it has come only 10% samples are not safe and have got some or other adulterate. And I think everywhere at the state government level, central government level, and all processes level, we have to be more vigilant, especially when we are collecting milk from the farmers and when milk is reaching to the dairies. We have to use the most modern technology to detect the adulteration. You know, technologies are right not fully available to check the adulteration at the village collection center. Whatever technologies are available are very, very expensive. But now gradually as the things are coming out, I think now we have to become more vigilant and to ensure that whatever milk we accept from the farmers, it is there's no adulterant.
Well, all of that said, there are high profit margins in this sector, and that seems to be luring the local and international players to this space. With more and more people now entering the milk and dairy sector, how have you seen the market competition, and how have you seen Amul's share, market share on that?
Well, you see, if I tell you, as far as the industry is concerned, we are producing, last year we produced 170 million metric tons. Out of that, 40% was consumed within the village, 60% was a surplus. But out of the 60% surplus, only one-third is coming to the organized sector, two-third is going to the unorganized sector or the milk contractors. So, second is, in India, milk production is growing at the rate of 4.5 to 5%. So, organized sector is getting growth. One is because of increase in consumption at 4.5% to 5%. Second, people shifting from loose or unorganized to the branded farm. So, the branded or organized dairy market is growing in the double digit, 10 to 12%. So, there is ample opportunity for everybody. As more big players who are entering India or other local corporates entering the dairy sector, it is good for the dairy segment or dairy industry, because farmers will be getting better price because of transparency. And when farmers get better price, they'll be encouraged to produce more. They'll be investing more. And dairy is such a segment, any farmer, even without a farmland, can get into dairy. The 80% of India's dairy producers are landless or marginal farmers. And the way our production is happening, today if it's 176 million metric ton, it is expected by 2050 it will increase to 530 million metric tons because of increase in consumption. The way prosperity is increasing in India, income level is increasing, per capita consumption is increasing at the rate of 4.5 to 5%. So, India will be the dairy to the world, and we cannot, depend upon imports like edible oil. We cannot afford imports, and for food security, we have to locally produce the whatever milk or milk products we want. So, we have to encourage farmers to produce more, and if we want to encourage farmers to produce, we have to give them better price. And better price is only possible if more organized players come into dairy sector.
Well, I just want to take that point forward, Mr. Sodhi. So, when you look at the Amul's market share into the markets right now, you of course are one of the biggest, but how do you see to maintain this market share or increase it going forward?
See, whatever is the total India's organized dairy sector, cooperative and private together, there is around capacity of milk procurement is of around 9 crore liter. Out of that, around 27% is with Amul. And out of whatever milk this year, we'll be procuring around 24 million liters of milk per day. Out of that, 85% in Gujarat and around 15% outside Gujarat. And our milk procurement is growing at the rate of around 14 to 15%. And we are expected to invest in another 3 years. Today, we have got 32 million liters capacity. And another 2.5 years, it will be around 40 million. And we'll be investing around 2,000 crore in new capacities within Gujarat and outside Gujarat. And overall, what I expect that in next 10 years, around 100 million liters capacity will be added in India. And 100 million liters means around 2 lakh crore investment is going to happen in India in dairy. And out of that 2 lakh crore, around at least 25% capacity expansion of around 25,000 crore will be done by Amul only. And more than the, you see, more than investment, the job creation, this 100 million liters extra capacity will produce around 2 crore jobs, because for 1 lakh liter, around 11,000 jobs are created at the farmers level and at the processing and at the marketing level. So, dairy is the one sector which can provide more jobs in the rural India. Dairy is the one sector which can really double the farmers' income in rural India.
Well, one feather, of course, has been the PM recently inaugurating a state-of-art facility in Gujarat for Amul. What is your sense? What kind of more further openings or expansions are you looking at? Because we do understand that you had also recently opened a state-of-art facility in Mumbai, near Mumbai as well. So what all is in the pipeline right now?
You see, as far as the new production facilities are concerned, our one new modern dairy has recently, we have started near Bombay. Then we are constructing two big dairy plants within Gujarat, one at Gandhinagar, which is going to be Asia's biggest dairy plant with a capacity of now 5 million liters milk per day. Then we are building a new dairy plant at Sabarkantha districts, then one dairy plant at Porbandar and Junagadh. Similarly, the existing dairy plant at Anand, as well as at other part of Gujarat, also expanding. Besides that, outside Gujarat, we are building a modern dairy plant in Calcutta, as well as we are going to build one dairy plant in near Delhi, the UP, then in one in Pune, and then we may be adding some other parts of India. But we are going to expand, like I said in the earlier, we are going to add every year around 600 to 800 crore rupees investment in the new dairy plant. As far as new products are concerned, because when you are getting milk, one has to add more milk. So first focus now for next few years will be launching lot of dairy sweets. You see, still sweets are in unorganized sector. So Amul is going to launch lot of dairy sweet with a shelf life of around 30 to 50 days. Besides that, we are going to launch lot of new variants in our beverages sector, Amul Cool, or we are just launched is a mango lassi, which is doing very well. And in ice cream segment, we are launching more ethnic product like kulfis. 5 varieties of new kulfis we have added. Now we are, next month we are launching Amul ice cream cake. So right, so you expect on an average 2 new products every month from Amul in the next 2 years.
Well, that's all about the dairy sector that you need to know about in the Indian markets, the milk prices, supply, demand, new launches, especially coming in from Amul, etc. But with that, that's all the time we have on this edition of Commodity Champions. Thank you for watching.